First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Proceeding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Proceeding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
All right. We back again with Dr. Aleem Elbey's show. And tonight, we have a very special guest. All right. Now, y'all got to be ready for this. This is Brother Wayne Chandler, and he's the author of Ancient Future. And tonight's show is going to be Return of Ancient Future. Brother Wayne, are you there?
I'm here, my brother.
Greetings, brother. How you doing tonight?
I'm doing well. Thanks for having me.
Oh, I appreciate you coming. I'm pretty sure the audience agrees, too. All right, we're going to get into some good info tonight. I'm pretty sure, I know I already had a question in which that, someone wanted you to deal with the sacred geometry in which that was mentioned in your book, Ancient Future.
Yeah, I mean, in what capacity, because everything around us, especially those elements that are connected to the natural frequencies and the natural environment of which we're a part of, although,
right,
you know, we don't really know that we're a part of that, most of us, but they're all designed, you know, with a natural geometric matrix, you know,
right.
So they're expressed in naturally geometric terms. All of what is produced through nature is expressed and produced through what we refer to today as sacred geometry.
Right. And, of course, we also refer to it as supreme mathematics, as well as also within the field of quantum physics. They refer to it as the golden mean or the golden ratio.
The golden mean, yes.
Right,
mm-hmm.
Or also referred to as pi. So we know that the human body is based on those particular mathematical codes also. So, like you said, everything within us and around us, you know, deals with the exact same mathematical frequencies. But I'm pretty sure that, you know, they just wanted something in general, and that was general enough for me. I don't know how they might feel about it, but, I mean, that was excellent to me. It explains, you know, as above, so below, as within, so without, and that's the supreme axiom. What do you want to share with us tonight? You know, anything in particular that you're working on right now?
Well, you know, my focus, you know, in these you know, last few years, you know, has just basically been, you know, how to guide folks into the awareness of their higher self, and,
right.
and not necessarily through the acquisition, you know, of left brain information, but actually taking people, you know, into creating a serious daily practice for themselves, you know, that lends itself to transcendence or transformation. So, you know, twice a year, you know, I hold retreats, 7-day retreats in Jamaica. And on those retreats, our focus, you know, is learning specific practices that shift consciousness, you know, and literally, you know, transform the body into more of its geometric crystalline expression, you know, of you know, pure, you know, higher dimensional, you know, alchemical substance. So the practices that we do utilize different techniques that literally activate pituitary and pineal vibrational frequency with the release of specific types of chemical compounds that impact the entire body and the rest of the endocrine system in the body. So anyone that comes, when they leave at the end of the 7-day period, you know, they are truly something else than what they were when they arrived.
Okay. When are these 7-day retreats available? Is there one coming up?
There's one coming up in August.
Okay.
You know, I have them twice a year. I have one in August, and I have one in February.
Okay. So August, around what time there?
August from the 9th to the 16th.
Okay. Okay, okay, okay.
You know, so that's one of the things I'm working on. I mean, I'm always, you know, bouncing around doing presentations and workshops here and there. I've got a workshop coming up the first part of June in Pittsburgh.
Okay.
Which will be June 9th.
Mm-hmm.
And I've also, you know, been working on a couple of manuscripts. You know, I've got a book that will be coming out shortly, and I'm working on two manuscripts. One is something I had started working on many years ago, and have just now really brought it to completion. So that will be coming out probably in the fall of this year. And then, of course, more substantial work will probably hit around the other side of 213 as we venture into that frequency.
Right.
But yeah, most of my... my focus for the last few years, you know, has been working with individuals, showing them how to basically activate, you know, their higher frequencies, you know, which lie dormant inside of them, you know, so that they can pretty much begin to shift and learn how to create, you know, the realities that they more or less dream about and don't have the ability to create. You know, one of the things, you know, that, you know, is our birthright, you know, is how to create our own reality so that we stay out of survival mode. And that's something
right.
that, you know, as a community of people here on Earth at this time, you know, it has been very, very difficult, you know, to acquire. We have all kinds of obstacles and distractions that are consistently in our way, and you know, we, because of that, are always, you know, pretty much running around in circles, and therefore, you know, it's the wrong kind of circle to be running around in, because there's nothing wrong with running around in circles, but we don't want to be running around in this circle with distraction as the core. You know, so we find ourselves in a pretty consistent state of desperation, you know, trying to make, you know, loose ends work. And that desperation keeps us in a constant state of fear, you know. And, you know, this is all what basically survival mode does. You know, survival mode generates desperation. Desperation generates fear. And just the impact that fear has on the body and the consciousness, you know, keeps individuals pretty much paralyzed in terms of what they can manifest and enact, you know, in their daily 24/7 regimens. You know, so my focus has really been on aiding people, you know, to discover that there is a different way, you know, and this is the way that our ancestors used in terms of creating the realities that they felt were more promising in terms of the type and the quality of yield, you know, that they produced. You know, so a lot of what I focus upon, you know, is giving people information, you know, I mean serious information, you know, not just left brain information, but a right brain doingness, you know, that allows true authentic transformation to take place, you know, because you can't really transform, and this is one of the keys, one of the main keys that allows individuals to attract to themselves that which they need is authentic, true self-integration. Once you become authentically self-integrated, you automatically become in alignment and in tune with universal frequency. The universe is the largest, most profound, integrated thing that we know. There's nothing greater in terms of its integrated mechanisms than that. Not being integrated, because living in this particular culture, we are not integrated beings, you know, because the culture is based on the design of being compartmentalized. It separates, disconnects, and segments everything, you know. So you can see the greatest example of that that most people will be able to identify or relate to within allopathic medicine. When you go to a doctor, you know, all doctors are broken down into what they refer to as specialists. So the body in itself, by design, works as a unit. Different areas of the body are connected to other areas of the body. So, for example, you know, the liver is connected to the eyes. You know, they work in conjunction with each other. Kidneys, ears, you know. So you have different elements within the body. If you have congestion in the lungs, you may very well, you know, have a severe constipation problem in the large intestine. So these are things, you know, that are ongoing, that are always working in a fashion that allows us to see the body holistically. But in this particular culture, that has been removed. And so we don't see the body holistically, so therefore we can't see ourselves holistically, so we can't really experience what it means to be an integrated and therefore to move, you know, in alignment with universal frequency and to be a part of the universe. So the problem with that is that if you're not integrated, if you're a non-integrated entity, because of the depth of integration within the universe, it doesn't even recognize you. So when people say, you know, the universe wants to give to you any and everything that you want, it's there to do that. The law of attraction works based on the dynamic or the mechanism of self-integration. Once you become self-integrated, you automatically connect with universal order and form and attract to you out of the universal structure or infrastructure all of those things of which you need or can envision or intend. And if you are not integrated regardless of how often you ask and desire and cry and pray, it ain't happening. And so you have a lot of individuals who go through those various routes, you know, and are not getting the results, even though they feel, you know, I'm on my knees every night. I'm on my doing this. I can't. God's not listening to me. You know, I don't understand what I'm doing wrong. I don't understand why my life is so horrible. I don't understand why I can't get just a little bit of what I need. You know, and it's all about self-integration. Because our life isn't supposed to be like it is. It's not supposed to be as laborious. It's not supposed to be as dense and hard, you know, as it is, and how we live that life on a daily basis. This isn't how we're supposed to be moving through our realities. So a lot of what I focus on with individuals is really teaching and instructing them how to become like self-integrated beings. And once that happens, then they begin to lock in and develop their own level of personal power. And once that happens, then they can begin to create the kind of realities that they want for themselves.
Mm. All right. So you basically just broke down the secret, the information which that was not revealed on there.
Exactly.
Because everything up to what you just said is what they taught, but they did not teach that final piece. And that's very important that you express that, because, like you said, there are hundreds and thousands and millions of people on their knees, you know, literally begging their higher self or God force within them in order to do something for them, but they have not integrated into their higher selves or merged their lower selves into their higher self. So therefore, they lack that connection. There's still a gap there. And I know one of the things in which that helps is the fact of, you know, us being melanated people in particular, you know, because if you read the book, The Unk, written by Nur Unk Amin, he speaks that in the third dimension, melanin has a gap in it. However, when ultraviolet light comes in contact with melanin, that gap is filled up and melanin becomes a superconductor. So that's also one of the ways of integration, and that's also through the practice of Qigong, Tai Chi, you know.
Meditation, yeah.
Meditation, breathing, exactly. So, you know, we definitely feeling you on that. Matter of fact, I had to go back in, when I read your book, Ancient Future, years ago, I had to go back and change my book because it was so similar, and, you know, which was Out of the Womb, Into the Mind, and I was like, yo, me and this brother is connected. And then I started doing more research on you and find out the schools that you've been through. I don't know if everyone knows the journey that you have taken, but can you, you know, go into a little bit of your journey?
Yeah, I mean, I've studied with you know, some of the tightest, you know, masters on the planet, you know. You know, I began my spiritual journey really in like 1970. And, you know, that began with yoga, you know, but yoga was very different back there in the day. You know, yoga was truly an integrated program, you know, that was designed, you know, for self-realization and not what yoga is today. Today, yoga is an exercise, you know, no more, no less.
Right.
And one of the things that, you know, we aspired for, you know, back during that period, you know, we weren't even thinking. We mastered the postures, you know,
right.
We mastered the postures. But the only reason we mastered the postures was because our focus was on the raising of the kundalini.
That's right.
You know, so, you know, the postures were just a means to an end. And our focus, our intent, you know, was kundalini activation, not the posture. You know, we just used the postures because we knew that once that, as they call it, the serpent fire began to rise, that if your body was not properly prepped and conditioned, it would tear your body apart. If the various nadis or meridians were not properly conditioned and opened to receive that level of intensity, when that energy moves through the body and hits all of those various circuits, you would explode. you know. So the asanas, the postures, were all based around creating and conditioning the body to be able to withstand the movement of that life force energy moving from the tail up into the higher spheres, you know, of the head. So that was my initial journey, you know, and again, you know, we embraced the Eightfold Path. So we were dealing with the concentration. We were dealing with every day, you know, how we lived our lives with the namas and niyamas. You know, we were dealing with, you know, meditative techniques. We were dealing with pranayama, you know, to open and activate. It was, as we saw it at that point in time, it was complete. But it really wasn't complete because even then we weren't getting all of the information. But my journey began there. I got to a place, this was before all of the different various structures were in play, as are in play today, you know, that more or less has delved in to control, you know, the whole yogic experience financially. So this was before any of those organizations, you know, had really become formed or formulated, even in, you know, conceptually. So I began to teach yoga. I taught yoga for several years, even in universities in the Washington, D.C. area. And soon after that, I guess my eyes were awakened when I, you know, I had a couple of masters. I studied with this brother by the name of Swami Vishnu Devananda. And he was my primary, teacher, instructor, or yogic master. You know, he was the one who was responsible for bringing yoga to the West. He had done a book called The Complete Illustrated Book of Yoga, you know, which was the premier text right. on yoga right. for the whole Western Hemisphere.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I began working with him. And, you know, that led me into working with, you know, his, I guess they were more or less, you know, his peers, you know, because they all studied what was called the Shivananda system of yoga. And they all came up under this one great yogic master named Shivananda. But Swami Satchidananda, who became the teacher and guru of Alice Coltrane, among many, many, many others, you know, was also one of my teachers, you know, who I was able to align myself with back in the day. But there was still a lot of information, you know, that I wasn't getting, and I really didn't understand that until I went and isolated myself up in the mountains in the Caribbean, you know, for about half a year and just began to practice yoga. That's all I did, practice yoga, the postures, the meditations, the pranayama. And at the end of that period of time, I felt that, you know, wow, I should be at a certain place. And I was at a different place, but it wasn't the place that I had envisioned for myself. So at that point, you know, I began to get exposed because you always have guides, and your guides will always drop information when you're ready. So my guides drop information. They said, well, you need to look in this direction, and you need to check this out, and maybe this will add the missing pieces, you know, to this jigsaw puzzle that you're trying to put together that deals with self-integration. So I began to move towards an individual by the name of Mantak Chia. Mantak Chia, his techniques were much more profound. They were pretty deep. And I had never really embraced a system that was as complete and as thorough a design for a person achieving higher consciousness as what he had penned and put in the various books that he had published. So I began reading a lot of his information and was very taken aback by it. And one of the pieces that he talked about significantly was what I would later come to be or later come to find out in terms of it being named was tongue connection, which I later found out in the yogic text is called Kachari Mudra. Now, Kachari Mudra is the technique of literally connecting. It's the first level of self-integration energetically where you connect the tongue and allow energy to move through the body, you know, in a very circular fashion. So there are two circuits that you're literally connecting, which once those circuits are connected, you have a certain level of life force that is now pulsating rhythmically through every area of your being. And Montauk was the only individual, you know, that was really talking about this. So I began using this particular technique, this particular principle, and I was just blown away by the power that it generated. And later, it would be years and years later, you know, that I would come to find out that in the yogic text that it was referred to as Kachari Mudra. And there was not one yoga instructor, white, black, East Indian, that had ever heard of Kachari Mudra. To this day, I'll ask yoga teachers, instructors, have you ever heard or do you practice Kachari Mudra? And they all, what is Kachari Mudra? They've never even heard of it. So what I discovered was that after working with the concepts of Montauk, that Kachari Mudra or tongue connection was one of the greatest, most guarded secrets out here on the planet with respect to transcendental cultivation. And the reason being is that it works and it moves you into a different realm of being. And when you apply other elements, practices to it, then it becomes even more profound and substantial in the opening and shifting of consciousness in the human body. So I just said to myself, you know, I've got to get with this guy. So before I actually got with him, I got with one of his senior instructors, which was, she lived up on an island in the Gulf Sea, and I went there and trained, you know, for my first level of certification in that system, and trained there for about 2 months straight, every day, every single day. My first class was at 5:30 in the morning. My last class ended at 8:00 at night. And that was every single day. After 2 weeks of training like that, and I had put in some good time, I had put in some good work prior to my arrival there. But after 2 weeks of training like that, I mean, I didn't even come out of my room the Monday of the second week, because the amount of energy that was moving through my body was so, like, just immeasurable that, you know, I had to take time to step back to be able to digest that level, you know, and just absorb that level of intensity. So for 2 days, you know, I didn't even leave my room, and I just, like, allowed the energy, you know, to move my consciousness as well as just how my whole cellular being was being repatterned. After I came out after 2 days, I was ready to go, and there was no looking back. About 2 years later, I met Montauk and began training with him. After that, I began working with, in the field of medical Qigong. And medical Qigong basically is, you know, how to utilize, cultivate, you know, inner power through the absorption of power from the outer environment, channel that through you, and use that to heal. It's a very intricate system, but it's a very, very powerful system that deals with remote healing or distance healing, as well as what you're doing with various individuals and correcting various imbalances, you know, that relate to health, and health on a physical level, emotional level, energetic level, and mental health as well. So it really realigns the body on all different levels of being and makes one, like, truly authentically integrated, so that they can, like, move through the world, you know, in a more holistic manner or fashion.
Right.
And that was with Master Chokak Sui.
Mm-hmm.
So that's been, you know, pretty much my journey. You know, I mean, I've, you know, strayed here and there, and I've gotten with this master and that master, and basically, you know, have picked up other jewels that weren't really locked into my my system that I may have been studying with Montauk, or I may have been working with Chokak Sui, you know. But, you know, getting with Yang Xuing Ming, you know, or Tao Wang, you know. So I've really pushed to find the best at what they did to get the highest quality of information that I could possibly acquire.
Right. I've also had some of those exact same teachers for the Pranic Healing, of course, Master Choa, as well as also I've studied under Mantak Chia, as well as also another teacher in which that you probably would probably want to sit up under or at least check out is Grandmaster Sunyata Saraswati. He's the one in which that brought the Tantra Kriya Yoga system here from out of the Orient and out of India in the 80s. He actually went through the same systems, Tibetan systems, and various other systems in which that Mantak Chia went through. And it's interesting because the same system or science in which that you just spoke about with Master Mantak Chia is also the same information which that was taught to me, my wife, and others up under the Shindao Monastery Temple system in which that we are part of, in which that, you know, I mean, it's just very interesting, the paths and the information and how people...
Yeah, the parallels, you know.
Right. You know,
yeah,
no doubt.
I mean, that's beautiful. That's powerful, you know, because there aren't a whole lot of folks, man, in our community that are like embarking upon that journey, you know. They just, it's just not there, you know. But, you know, studying, you know, when I was isolated on an island, you know, it was very monastic, and that really laid the template, you know, for my Jamaica retreats, because what I discovered is that even when you do your own daily practice, you know, there's nothing like laying a foundation of when you isolate yourself and there are no distractions whatsoever. And 24/7, you're in the mix of just doing a variety of different conscious shifting, energetically cultivating practices, building life force, and, you know, embracing the different, you know, Qigong as well as Nigong dynamics, you know, in your reality, and doing that on a daily basis. There's nothing, you have to transform, and that's what I discovered, is you have to shift. There's no way you cannot shift. Even, I mean, there were several people there who were pretty jammed up emotionally, and you know, emotional low base emotional frequencies create a lot of disorders within the various areas of the body, the organs, the meridians or nadis, which affect consciousness. And when you start trying to move energy into and through, you know, those areas that are like congested with emotional debris, all hell breaks loose, you know. And I've seen some really pretty profound things in terms of individuals just, you know, losing it and having to be flown out by helicopter, you know, because, you know, the energy and the practices that they were embracing were too intense, you know, and they were just too emotionally disturbed and congested, you know, to really really acquire any great benefit. But there was release, and that release would later allow them to have some degree of emotional balance and stability, you know, in their lives, just based on what they were able to let go of during the short time that they were doing these practices. You know, so the Jamaica template, you know, is based on a level of consistent training, ongoing, every single day we do the same thing. And that literally begins to repattern and rewire, you know, just the whole psychic, energetic, and cellular levels of the being, you know. And therefore, when you're doing something like that daily, consistently, repatterning is the only inevitable result. And so that's the template that I use based on the training that I did, you know, at Silent Ground.
Interesting. Now, in all this, I guess, solitude and, I guess, silence, when we speak about reaching a particular level, I know for myself, I've seen a white light or a point of white light, and many speaks about, you know, seeing that point of white light, you know, was there anything, you know, particular in which that you experienced during that particular, you know, I guess you can say, I guess some would say that we was probably would be so more of a hermit, but that solitude, I mean, did you, anything particularly happen?
Yeah, on the 18th day. On the 18th day, when I was at Silent Ground, on the 18th day, I had started, one of the things that we were taught was a technique called kidney breathing and kidney packing. At the time, I really wasn't told the science, you know, of doing that particular technique. I had never done it before. But later, in working with another brother by the name of Tao Huang, I would learn the science, and the science was when you do kidney breathing, kidney packing, there are meridians that run from the kidneys and connect to two small pea-sized glands in the brain called the amygdala. The amygdala, in turn, connect to the pituitary, of which, you know, underlies the Ajna chakra.
Yes.
So when you do kidney breathing and kidney packing, if you're consistent with that particular practice, you will eventually, inevitably, activate the Ajna chakra through the stimulation of the pituitary. And once the pituitary begins to release the pituitrin, then the Ajna chakra is brought into activation, and then your sixth sense becomes incredibly active. It becomes becomes it comes online, as people would say in today's vernacular. You know, it comes online. But that was the 18th day. I'll never forget it. All of a sudden, my forehead began to pulsate and throb, and I didn't know what the hell was going on. I knew it was like right over, you know, the ajna, and I was, you know, inquiring about it. You know, so I talked to one of the teachers there. I said, you know, I've got this throbbing in my forehead. And I was wondering, you know, like if you might be able to explain to me what exactly is going on. Because, you know, having a heartbeat in your head, you know, that gets your attention. And you want to make sure that everything is okay. You know, you're doing some serious practices, some serious meditations. You're shifting. You just want to make sure that everything is still, you know, in line. And so she told me, she said, yeah, I get that every now and then, you know, when I do practices. But mine, you know, was becoming more and more regular. And, I believe it was the 9th of November, it hit full blast, never turned off. You know, so over the years, I've learned how to condition it, control it, you know, how to use it with respect to intention, you know, how to project it to get information, you know, from the ethers intuitively, you know, because it's an amazing, you know, because it's your sixth sense. So it's an amazing intuitive device and faculty that helps you to navigate, you know, the density of this reality that we're in. And so that's one of the things what's one of the first things that I teach, you know, is the kidney breathing, how to breathe into the kidneys and how to pack energy into the kidney to activate the pituitary and turn on the ajna.
Interesting. I'm pretty sure everybody is interested on that Jamaica trip. Tell us one more time on when it's going to be. Is there a course, besides for, of course, the travel expenses and everything, tell everybody what they need to have for themselves, because I'm pretty sure they're interested in coming. I know I am.
Yeah, the Jamaica trip, I'm going to post it probably tomorrow on my Facebook page, you know, so anybody that really wants to get, you know, the particulars, you know, of that trip, it'll all be up there by design. I bring in a different sister every year to do the yogic portion, you know, because I found that doing something that is more a person that has more of a holistic approach, you know, to the yogic science and is working, you know, with the breath, not just the physical dynamics, helps to align individuals for the work that I'm going to be exposing them to, you know, after the early morning yoga class. So we have an early morning yoga class. After that, we break. You know, we have a very light fruit-based, coconut water-based breakfast. And then there's a slight break in between, and then we go into practices, you know, for a good part of the day until we break later for lunch. And then we practice again, and then we break for dinner, you know. We have beach days. We have one beach day. We have shopping day. And, you know, but the focus is transformation. You know, that is the focus. And, you know, the date is August the 9th. We start August the 9th through the 16th of August. And you know, the price will be you know, on the flyer, you know, it's, you know, for everything, you know, it's $1,050, you know, and that's like, you know, room and board, all your meals, the trips to and fro from the airport to the beach to go shopping covers everything. Yeah, it's cheap. I know.
Yeah. We have some questions, so I'm going to go to the lines and see. We got area code 253. Area code 253, you're on the line.
Peace, peace. How's it going tonight?
You're doing well.
I have a question. It's not on this topic right here. I've been trying to get some answers to, like, what the original souls, how many original souls were there when creation was started? Is there, like, a certain number that we can, that can be thrown out there, or is there a way to research that?
I have no idea. I wouldn't even know how to begin to research something like that. And I'm not saying that no one would have that information, you know, but because people write about everything. But, you know, my question to you would be, why would you want to know that information?
Well, I don't know. That was just one I was meditating on, and reincarnation popped up in my head, and you know, I want to get information on, like, my past life experiences, and then I just started to think, Lord, how many souls were there were created, you know, if we reincarnate into different lifetimes, like how many souls were there originally created?
Yeah, I mean, we reincarnate into different lifetimes, you know, but the whole idea of the soul in itself, you know, you have a lot of different, you know, different philosophies have different spins or takes, you know, on exactly what constitutes the soul and the journey of the soul and what that looks like to them. You know, the Chinese have one, you know, the East Indians have another. You know, the comedic tradition in science has another. And then you have to deal with, you know, there are souls that came as one that were, you know, split and began to move in different directions or take on different journeys. And most of the time when that happened, you know, the whole concept of the twin flame was created. You know, and so, you know, which, and the twin flame is different, you know, than the soulmate, you know, because anyone can really be a soulmate. You know, soulmates come into your life basically to teach you various lessons, you know, that you need to learn at a particular time. But the twin flame is actually, you know, your other half. It's actually an aspect of you. It's your opposite, you know. And spoken tradition in the Greek philosophies, you know, or the mythologies, I should say. And in the Greek mythologies, they talk about, you know, the Titans, you know, and how great the Titans were, and that they had become so profound in terms of their capacity and abilities, you know, to manipulate the physical domain, that they looked at themselves as the true gods. And those gods looked upon the Titans, you know, as being arrogant. And in doing that, they felt that the Titans would have to be taught a lesson. And in teaching them the lesson was that they split them in half, you know, so that the masculine and the feminine would go its separate ways, and that, you know, one would always be searching and looking, longing for the other half of itself. So from that comes the whole concept or idea of the twin flame, you know. But when you get into the deeper mythos, you know, or the spiritual, the deeper spiritual philosophies of a lot of the ancient sciences, they talk about the souls, our souls being as one, that many of them have split and have gone in different directions to create different journeys, you know. And sometimes, you know, people come back in contact with their twin flame, you know, in various incarnations. So to know how many souls were created, I have no idea.
Well, brother, it sounded like you answered it. It was one in which that split. and that's what I was getting ready to actually expound on, is that the one soul in which that, you know, in which that we would say was created, actually it wasn't created, because as we know that the Kundalini is the all-pervasive energy of the universe, and creation was produced from her, you know, the Mother Goddess principle, which is the divine soul. And she produced the moon stars and the heavenly bodies and everything in which that is within from herself. You know, so when we're talking about the one soul or the one God, you know, whatever name in which that we choose, you know, to utilize, whether it's the masculine or the feminine quality of that particular source in which that we are referencing, it is still that one power, that one, you know, force. You know, it's the same force in which that when we practice the Qigong or Tai Chi or Reiki or Pranic Healing or any other energy modality or anything else, when we breathe, when our heartbeat is the Kundalini, when we drink water, that is the Kundalini. When we do anything, you know, it's the Kundalini. You know, it's prana energy. It's prana or chi or ki energy. So that is the one soul itself, you know, in which that has divided within many attributes within one in particular, as he stated, the twin souls, you know. Hopefully we answer, you know, or, you know, try to answer your question the best as we could. We're going to go to another caller, 609-609, you're on the line.
Big greetings.
Peace.
Very enlightening. I have a couple questions myself, so not on the particular topic, but Dr. Aline, I wanted to know if you could explain, give a better understanding to what the galactics are. I heard somebody saying something about people such as, like, JFK and, like, Princess Di were cloned, and, like, the galactics preserved their bodies, and they'll, you know, be back to speak in present form. And I'm just trying to get a little better understanding on the galactics. I understand a little bit about that being something related to the angelic forms that that rescues different bodies and different entities at certain times, but I'm just trying to get a clear understanding on what that is.
Well, angels or angles of light are actually projections in which that there's 50 portals within the mind, in which they are known as actually tunnels, in which that these angelical beings or celestial forces can actually be projected from, in which that can act on your behalf, because they are thought forms personified, because people have believed within angels or these celestial forces or beings for so long till actually they can become personified and actually work on your behalf. You know, this is like incidences in which that have occurred, such as a woman who might have had an accident, the car turns over, she need help, you know, opening up the door can't open, a stranger all of a sudden appears, open up the door, she gets her child out, and then, you know, she turns around, and that individual or person or whatever we would want to refer to it as is gone, you know.
Right.
So, I mean, these types of things happen all the time, and so, yes, when we talk about the galactic, you know, you can actually refer to those particular beings. And then, of course, you have which are called interdimensional beings. And then, of course, you have extraterrestrials, which actually is extra-astral energy on Terra, which is Earth. And that can actually be nothing more than the rays of the sun, the celestial forces, you know, such right now the sun is going through a heavy solar flare activity. And those solar flares, 300,000 tons of stardust energy force to the planet Earth daily. And during solar flare activity, it increases. So you as a melanated being, you absorb these particular astral energies or these rays. And the word astral simply means star. But the sun is a star. All right. So when we're talking about you absorb extra star energy. You know, because scientists have, quantum physicists have found out that your body is nothing but composed stardust. You are a walking star. So what does a star need in order to
ground us from the, stardust coming from the sun?
Well, it comes from the cosmos. But yes, right now we have a heavy solar flare activity in which that is going on, in which that large amounts of solar plasma, what's called coronal mass ejections or CMEs, or the solar flares, mega flares, super flares are bombarding the planet Earth at this particular time. You know, so, I mean, and then when we talk about aliens, you know, that can be anything foreign coming from outside of us, such as it is said about these beings in which that travels on ships. You know what I'm saying? If they're traveling on a metal ship, I don't really need them and not concerned. You know, they are our brothers and they are here and they just basically got one technology or so up above us, you know, and they're able to do what they do. You know, we also had that same technology in ancient Egypt, Akemet, Tamaray.
Right.
So, I mean, I'm not, you know, impressed. You know, I'm also concerned about transforming my body into a ship doing what is called the macabre breath techniques, in which that is 18, 24, and 28, in which that I can actually transform and travel the galaxies or the cosmos, you know. So I'm more concerned about that than actually looking at something outside of me, you know what I'm saying, coming in order to save me. That's how me and White Jesus had a fallout.
Right, right. That's really the real rapture, right? When you talk about that, being able to rapture yourself.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly. That's the transformation and twinkling of an eye. And that's what Brother Wayne been breaking down for the last hour, is that this is going to be a transformation, you know, that you have to do, you know.
Right.
Brother Wayne, you have anything that you want to say on that?
When one stands out there, when he does do that, you know, based with the solar flare activity, and make sure that he outstretches the arms, you know, he wants to keep the arms outstretched, you know, because a lot of that energy moves through the various portals, and one of the main portals is the chakra points up under in the armpit that a lot of that energy is absorbed directly into.
Oh, that's beautiful, because that will help with the lymphatic system and the lymph nodes.
Exactly, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Get rid of them toxins and poisons that the body don't need.
Right, right. Brother Wayne, do you think that even during this transformation process and practicing the breathing techniques, that a person can elevate to the point of having telekinetic powers?
Oh, of course. I mean, all of that... The most important thing is for you to recognize who and what you are, you know, because we live in a three-dimensional construct, but you're not a three-dimensional being. You're not a three-dimensional entity. You're, by design, you're a fourth-dimensional entity that is getting ready to step in a fifth-dimensional vibrational frequency. And being fourth-dimensional means that this is why you have all the chakras, you know, in your body that you have. This is why you have the various subtle bodies that operate, you know, within the gross physical form. You know, these are the areas or the bodies that we really don't make connection with, but are designed, you know, to be as higher vehicles to experience much higher realities and to give you abilities in terms of how to manipulate, control, and redirect the energies of a three-dimensional, you know, infrastructure like the one that we live in. So you're already there by design. You're already there. You just have to recognize that you are there and then begin to practice some authentic techniques that will allow you to basically shed your three-dimensional construct, because it's the three-dimensional construct that keeps you incarcerated. And so that's what you want to step out of and step into the real you. You know, we're already by design where a lot of us read, you know, in terms of our potentialities. You know, the problem is that, you know, we don't really want to do the practices that are designed to, like, allow us to shed this three-dimensional reality that this culture has basically heaped upon us to keep us disconnected, you know, from, you know, our fourth-dimensional self. And so that's when you look at, like, 2012, the whole idea of 2012, you know, is to begin. It's a beginning. You know, we've been in the interim between two time periods, you know. So in 2012, on December 21st, we begin to move into a totally new vibrational frequency, and its purpose is the realignment of consciousness, you know, with your fourth dimensional self. And it's about dropping the three-dimensional construct that you have basically been paying homage to, you know, for the last several thousand years. This okay. time is coming to an end. It's about the reinstatement Absolutely. Of natural time. So when they say that, you know, it's about the end, it's an end. It's a moving away of a construct that has been all about limitation, about fear instead of unconditional love. It's been all about entrapment. It's been all about, you know, what we can do as beings that only have a very limited scope of reality, and how the culture utilizes that so that our list is not a laundry list, you know, of what we can accomplish. It's a very short list of maybe 10 things that we can possibly do, and those things that we can possibly do are not even for ourselves. You know, they're for the larger culture at large, you know, that gives us the illusion or the idea that we're doing it for ourselves, like the accumulation, you know, of all the material things that we can possibly fit into our homes, you know, our storage lockers that we'll never use, you know, like half of during our lifetime. It's the acquisition, you know, of as much finance as you possibly can hoard and not really utilize to put it out there in the world, because money is just energy, you know. So just right. to utilize it in a proper way so that it's self-generating, you yeah. know. We don't even know that, so we hoard it. We keep it, you know. There's so much that we do not understand about just this particular time frame that we're in and what we're getting ready to be launched into, and we're not prepared.
Wow.
You know, we're not prepared. So, you know, Dr. Eileen Bay is locking down information and putting things on the table that are all about preparation. I'm locking down, putting things on the table that's all about self-preparation. Because
right.
there's a saying in the Hopi ledger, the Hopis, in their prophecies, they say that in 2012, there will come to be a tear in the fabric of time, and yeah. those who have prepared themselves will be able to walk right through, which
wow.
tells you that those who have not prepared themselves ain't really going anywhere. So as we move into the end of this year, December 21st is all about now. You must understand, not even understand, you have to create the understanding that the gray area, the neutral zone, is dead. It has been removed. It has been taken off of the table. It no longer exists. There is only the dark. There is only the light. You're either a part of the solution or you're a part of the problem. If you try to occupy the neutral zone, if you try to live in the gray area, then you're part of the problem.
This is almost a reflection of the story that's in the Bible about the five wise virgins and the five foolish virgins.
Exactly. Who had lamps and ones who had oils for their lamps and ones who had lamps but no oil.
No oil, right.
Right, no preparation, right. They weren't prepared.
Exactly.
Us as a people. Exactly. That's us as a people. Exactly.
Yeah.
Our foolish virgins. Exactly.
Yeah.
Thank you, brother. We're going to go on. We got some more callers here.
Okay.
Thank you. All right, caller 804, area code 804, you're on the line.
Peace, Dr. Aleem. And I just caught the brother about 25 minutes ago. I would like for him to build on the glances of the eyeball, right? Because I seen the contrails come down with the naked eye. I'm talking about, you know, ground level. And it was coming down like spider webs and like 3 to 4 inches length. And it had a murky look. I haven't seen it but one time. And when I first saw it, it scared the mess out of me, and I jumped from the window for about 30 seconds, and I went back to the window, and I just looked at it. It was, you know, each screen had its own space, like snow coming up, you know, coming down. It was floating like that. It was a July of last year.
Right. And, well, you know that the chemtrails in which that do come down, those are bacterial spores. I mean, it's aluminum, barium, different other elements, which is reflective agents, but in particular, bacterial spores are used in which that is now causing a disease called Magellan, in which that is attacking the body. Like Magellan is going to be like the 21st century disease. If we thought that AIDS was the 20th century disease, then supposedly Magellan is supposed to be the 21st century disease. So, and it's being caused by these particular chemtrails, and it's nothing more than an act of population control agenda by the Rockefellers. I mean, this is why they're using frankenfoods, genetically altered food, the Terminator seeds by Monsanto. All of these things are part of the same strategy.
And see, the reason I was specifically saying the glances are the eyeballs, because everybody that I done asked, and I listen to a lot of radio, and I never heard anybody say that they saw this chemtrail or to describe it. And
I've seen it, brother, so I know exactly what you're talking about. As a matter of fact,
they're like spider webs, right?
Yeah, they look just like spider webs, exactly.
3 to 4 inches in length.
Mm-hmm. I've seen some even longer.
And people was walking right through it, won't even feeling it. It scared the death out of me. And remember that other experience? Now, see, Dr. Lynn, I do the pot belly technique, right? Because I just can't do too much of an intake, you know, through my respiratory, you know, my nostril.
We just breathe through the top of our heads. I mean, actually, we have a pranic tube in which that is still there on the inner side of our spine, in which that we can actually still breathe prana through up from the earth and down from the heavens and actually meet the point at the heart chakra, in which that illuminates and which that stores the energy there. So, and you can also do another technique called breathing through your pores, in which that, you know, you can actually breathe through your skin pores. Now, of course, before you do it, I would recommend utilizing some type of herbal cleanser, you know, such as in your bath, you know, some type of bath.
Dangerous.
You know,
it's dangerous. Mm-hmm. It's dangerous because I don't know how to release this stuff, and I'm very unbalanced, and I'm not disciplined as I used to be. But my body will call me to, like, breathe. See, I like to breathe through my mouth, the pop belly.
That's because through the mouth, when you breathe in through your nose and breathe out through your mouth, actually what it does is relieve toxins. You know, I mean, actually those are actually Tibetan techniques for the release of toxins. They still are, those techniques are still practiced today in the Tibet series. Mm-hmm.
And see, and remember that experience I had spoke recently when you had Brother Williams on. Then I walked through that guard checkpoint going into the Winter Palace.
Right.
That was very, very subtle, and I didn't notice it till after I got back to the United States, and that was like several months later. And I seriously believe now that I was invisible, because they do not let them Negroes in the Winter Palace in Luxor. Remember how I told you how the white dude ran up on me, and
right.
The first two things came out of his mouth was, how you get in here, who let you in here? I walked past the check-in, check-out point and everything. You see what I'm saying?
Well, I mean, you was in a zone where, I mean, those pyramids acts as vortex, you know, vortexes. I mean, actually, as it reached towards this particular time, those pyramids were supposed to begin to start humming, and we begin to start making our own sound or vibration in which that would resonate to the other mounds and pyramids throughout the world, in which that's supposed to be actually on ley lines and energy grids already. So those are nothing more than chakra points and / meridians and nadis, in which that we built, you know, for the earth, because the earth is a living entity. And the earth has a kundalini, which is a sun, in which that is about 600 miles in diameter at the core. So, you know, all of these things are taking place right now. And the Schumann resonance of that heart beat, which is that particular sun, has now grown from 7.83 hertz to now to 13 hertz. And supposedly by the time it reaches 14 hertz, and with the electromagnetic field of the earth supposedly reaching zero, we're supposed to go into 0 point, according to Greg Braden. So we'll see exactly how all of that is going to take place.
And right, because see, that hop, you know, with them frequencies, that's very dangerous, you know. And I wonder how they're going to play in on, you know, those who choose to take time out to travel in such a way.
The harp system is used, it can be utilized to not just manipulate the weather conditions and patterns, but also a mind control tool. So for those who are on those frequencies, it's no coincidence that the cell phones oscillates at 800 megahertz, while your brain oscillates approximately 800 megahertz. So with the harp system and with the cell phones, all of those things can tap into the brain waves and actually mind control the individual. But Brother Wayne, you have anything you want to build on that?
When he first made the statement,
about the glasses and the eyeballs.
Well, yeah, about the you know, the webs, you know, falling through the atmosphere. That you were referring to as chemtrails, it reminded me of a similar incident that took place in the early 70s in the area of Atlanta. And during that time, there were massive UFO sightings. And one of the things that was happening as these UFOs were moving through space, you know, through the atmosphere, is whatever propulsion source they were utilizing in their craft, it released these webs that fell through the atmosphere, and just before they would hit the earth, they would disintegrate. And that's, you know, when when you said that, I went straight back to that particular story, because I had cut that article out of the paper, because during that time in the early 70s, you know, there were thousands and thousands, you know, of UFO sightings in various parts of the country. But that one particular sighting that went on in the Atlanta area for probably a good solid month, you know, one of the characteristics was the release of these spider-like webs that would, like, fall through the atmosphere and just kind of disintegrate, you know, before they would hit the earth. So that, you know.
Right. I know I heard Dr. Deborah Bliss speaks about the fact that there's extraterrestrials in which that, as Brother Wayne was talking about, in which that large sighting of the UFOs, and no coincidence with the spider webs, in which that, according to Dr. Deborah Blair, those things, you know, actually can change our DNA. So actually we are being upgraded, you know, by these particular ancestors or extraterrestrials, as they are also referred to as, you know, or aliens, as they refer to as too. It's just alien to those who don't understand, is that we had technology way beyond the technology in which they we have today on planet Earth. But it's something to definitely continue checking into, you know. But we're going to go to the next caller. Thank you, brother.
Hey, Dr. Ali, hey, look. Hey, look, can you call me after, you know, after the show? Can you please call me for at least 2 minutes?
Oh, yeah, give me a call. You have my number?
I don't have your number, and I'm out walking.
Oh, okay. All right, hopefully your number is still up here on the call line. I'm going to try to call you, okay?
All right, please do, bro, please.
Peace, brother.
Peace.
All right, we got another caller, area code 804, you're on the line.
Hi, good evening. Fascinating dialogue. I'm working on bringing spirituality into global economics and combine it with unconditional love. I've had bizarre experiences throughout my entire life, which include UFO, paranormal, and near death, and I'm standing in my truth as sort of like a way shower, and I'm a master, a self-taught master of what I term creative utilization of information, and I'm bringing into the marketplace strategies that are of absolutely no risk to businesses, but they're actually a strategic intelligent enhancement that will allow businesses at will to expand and diversify to an unlimited degree in any field and create jobs and opportunities at the same time. It's totally transparent, highly ethical and moral, and will force companies to be more responsible for their employees, their customers, the environment, and the community. I'm wondering if any of you have researched anything in those areas, or if you're interested in that, because I could give my name and you can see some interesting things on the internet.
As for myself, I mean, I haven't researched that specifically in terms of what you're doing, you know, but I would say that I mean, this is the time for all of those types of projects to be downloaded, you know, because just of the shifts that are taking place in consciousness, basically, you know, you're being wired. I mean, basically what you were saying is that you are channeling, you know, information of just a higher frequency, you know, which is encoding you with different design patterns for how to change, you know, the dense programs that we've been using to acquire certain attributes of this three-dimensional reality, you know, and make it a lot easier, you know, and a lot more fluid in terms of where we, by design, are getting ready to go. So, I mean, what you're saying is that you have an equation for how to manifest new age concept and technologies, and that's in line, you know, with you know, our current program. I mean, that's in line with, you know, the current journey, you know, that we as human beings are being you know, conditioned for, set up for, repatterned for.
Yes, and I'll give
brother,
you an
please
example.
Please give us your name and give us your website, and everybody can definitely go and check that out.
My name is Hugh, H-U-G-H. The last name is Charlson, T like Tom, R-A-U-L-S-E-N as in Nancy. If you put a .com after that, you'll come to a site, click on historical articles. You'll see a front page Wall Street Journal article from back in the 80s where I exposed the former federal government bureaucrat indirectly, and eventually led to the resignation of Jim Wright from Speaker of the House in shame. There's a letter from President Obama on there, and if you just Google my name, you'll see other things on the internet. But I'm going to give you just a quick example of the power of what I term creative utilization of information, how a few words can do a lot. I composed a little poem back in the 80s. It's on a site, creativity777.com. It's in the President Ronald Reagan Library, discussed as a weapon against terrorism in the interview that can be downloaded from the blog, and currently I'm using it to help the people of Haiti who can't help themselves. The poem is titled Caring Sharing. It reads, if you dare to care, then share. If you share, pay heed. God will reward every good deed. It sort of sums up what life should be all about.
No doubt about that, brother. Thank you. And everybody should have that. And we appreciate you coming on, sharing that info with us. Thank you.
Thank you, and God bless everyone.
All right. Peace and blessings to you. All right. We got area code 321. Area code 321. You're on the line.
What?
Ah. Peace.
Hello?
Salute to everyone. Yes, salute to everyone.
Yes, 321 area code. You on the line?
Yes, how you doing? How you doing?
Oh, we doing well, brother.
Yes.
Have a question?
I have a question for Dr. Wayne.
Yes.
Yes, he was talking about integrating to the universe as far as law of attraction is concerned. Could he give more information about that?
Yeah, sure. You know, basically, you know, we're designed in a very particular format, and our initial divine design is all about integration as opposed to compartmentalization. Compartmentalization happened when the cultural program that we're a part of right now came in and moved consciousness into a predominantly left brain reality. Now, when you look at the characteristics of the left brain deals, for one thing, it's time bound, which means that it believes in a very finite reality. It believes that everything that is must come to an end. You know, it processes information bit by bit. You know, it's sequential in that it's linear. It only sees reality in a linear construct. It splits the world into identifiable bits and pieces. So everything around you is compartmentalized, and the idea of holism goes straight out the window. Now, the right hemisphere of our brain is timeless as opposed to being time bound. It processes information all at once instead of bit by bit. It's simultaneous, and it looks at the whole and it connects the world into a connected whole. Now, those are just some of the basic characteristics of the right and the left hemisphere. Both of those realities coexist in your being, in your consciousness. You have the ability to choose which way you want to go. Do you want to embrace a death-based, segmented reality, or do you want to embrace an immortal, holistic reality? So when you become self-integrated, you're basically integrating both right and left hemispheres, which in turn create, you've heard the whole conversation, the dialogue that goes on now, you know, in the spiritual community about mind, body, soul, or mind, body, spirit relationships. But nobody really talks about the significance of what that really means. What is a true, authentic mind-body-spirit relationship? You know, when you have a true mind-body-spirit connection or fusion, that means that the mind, the internal landscape of your body, which means your organs and your glands, are in constant communication with each other. It means that there is an awareness in the consciousness that speaks and connects to the individual awareness and realities of the different organs and glands in your body, because each organ and gland in your body has its own field of consciousness. It has its own field of awareness. So once you, in your consciousness, acknowledges that and begins to make, communicate or create dialogue with your inner environment, then your organs begin to communicate and begin to sense a much profound, much more profound connection between you and your consciousness and the body of which you are a part. You are not the body, but you basically are utilizing this vehicle to move around in your three-dimensional reality. Once this begins to happen, then you have a sense of integration that begins to take place on a totally different level, because you now are operating in a totally different level of awareness within the consciousness of your being. You are now creating dialogue with your organs. You're creating dialogue with your glands. Once you begin to create dialogue with your glands, then there's integration between the glands and the chakras that oversee the glands in your body, mainly the endocrine system. Once this begins to happen, then you open yourself up to a much greater sphere of spiritual connection, a much more dynamic dialogue that takes place between your actual creative fourth dimensional self and your ability to create. So integration, authentic self-integration, is connecting all the different levels of being that you operate under. You operate through the various bodies that are encased within the physical body. You become aware of the different dimensional fields that project, vibrate, and give you different levels of information all of the time that you are completely and totally unaware of. All of these things now become very, you become very cognizant, you become very aware of in your daily routine, and you're able to like connect into much greater reservoirs or sources of information that you up until then thought were impossible. And it all comes through self-integration. So self-integration comes through doing specific types of practices which aligns body, mind, spirit connection or connectivity. And, you know, the practices are just like a foundation. They create a foundation, and you don't even have to really delve into extensive regimens, you know. Like in one of my systems, I have what is called the six healing sounds. The six healing sounds, you know, is using the breath to activate and the removal of certain energetic and emotional toxins from the organs. Once you begin to train the consciousness into the application, you know, of that removal or that process of removal, the organs begin to identify you as being now an integrated being, because you are consciously connecting with them to relieve them of the various stresses and toxic emotional fields that they have accumulated through the way you've been living your life. Because there's consciousness in the organs, they then respond in like and develop a different relationship with you in your consciousness. In other words, your body begins to develop a totally different relationship with the conscious mind. So self-integration is about that.
Brother, was your question answered?
Definitely. Yeah.
All right. Thank you for calling in. Let's go to the next caller. We got area code 561. Area code 561, you're on the line.
Hello.
Yes.
Hey, how you doing, Dr. Ham?
Doing well. How are you?
Oh, I'm doing great. This is Henry from West Palm Beach.
Yes, peace, Brother Henry.
Hey, peace. And I can respect the fact that you allow these brothers, you know, to have free reign on your talk blog, your blog talk radio and everything. And this call is just about to big you up and from allowing me to be a part of your whole blog and the things that I have learned from, you know, us on Facebook, and we talk a few times on the telephone and stuff, and that is a big part of my life. I came in contact with you through the YouTube, through my brother Don Ringham, which is listening right now, put me on YouTube, and I was like, wow, there's a whole lot of information, a whole lot of people to learn from and to eat from, and I just wanted to say that, and appreciate you, brother. Keep doing what you're doing, and I follow all your stuff. Got your book, read it, eat it, and meditate on it.
All right. Appreciate that, brother.
No problem.
All right.
Okay.
Peace and blessings.
Same to you and your...
All right, we're going to go to the next caller. 919-919, area code 919, you're on the line.
Hello?
Yes, peace.
Peace. Peace, Dr. Wang and Dr. Arlene. I'm really getting a lot of information tonight, and I have a quick question. I have for both of you. I heard you speak earlier on heart and mind control, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. I think it was the tsunami in Japan in 2011, I believe that was. The day before or the night before that, I remember the moon was very, very low, and I remember looking at it and saying, wow, that's just really weird. It almost looked like you could look up and touch it. Well, that night, in a dream, I remember like I was kind of like astral travel to Japan and being almost like kept in a high school gymnasium, and it was snowing. And I was like, wow, that's really weird. I never had a dream like that before, only to find out the next morning that there was the tsunami and all of the terrible things that happened with that. And I just wanted to know, you know, if you possibly think that could have been a form of mind control and how people like myself can protect ourselves from psychic attacks from these types of things. And do you think that yoga is a good practice for that?
I mean, I'll take a shot at that first. I don't think yoga is good for anything is the way it's practiced and taught today. I'm sorry.
Right.
You know, and I apologize to all the yogis and yoginis out there, you know, but, you know, I'm coming from an old school program. I've seen what it was, what it attempted to be, and then what it is now. With respect to actual psychic protection, energetic repatterning, that will build a stronger aura, you know, auric field, a sheath around the body. I don't see it, because you have to utilize, you know, the breath, you know, to begin that journey. And yoga teachers today really don't expound on pranayama any longer. You know, yoga has become a very deliberate form of physical exercise that is geared more towards, you know, physical health and endurance. And what, again, you know, you want to engage specific types of practices that really work the various energetic fields, you know, of the body, the electromagnetic, the etheric, you know, the astral. You want to be able to, like, engage these various fields. And you want to also create a dialogue, you know, between your own personal awareness and those faculties of awareness that operate and exist within the different chakras of the body. Because one of the main areas of psychic contamination, you know, with us is the area of the solar plexus. You know, the solar
right.
plexus area literally feeds and opens into, you know, the other dimensional realms, especially that of the astral, you know. So the way the chakra is made is that you have what's called the chakra web. The chakra web is a field or a web that literally by design stops the penetration of other types of elementals or entities entering into your being. And what happens through our daily activities and how we live our lives, the emotional stressors, the various low base emotional frequencies that we encounter over a period of time literally tear, create rips, and literally begin to disintegrate these chakra webs, you know, that the chakras contain, and allows all kinds of unwanted entities, you know, and elementals to penetrate, you know, the being. And so it's about how do you repair that, you know?
Right.
And so, again, you go back into doing certain types of practices which in turn establish, you know, or reestablish, you know, connectivity between the various bodies, you know, in your being, especially specifically dealing with the chakra system, you know. So I can't really tell you over a phone what that would be. I can demonstrate that to you and teach you that, but in terms of saying, well, this is what I want you to do in terms of using breath science. Now, depending on where you are in terms of your meditative abilities, your abilities for, like, applying concentrative intent to go in and then repattern and repair, you know, different elements or aspects of the self, that's a whole nother realm, you know. And if you have that ability to do that, you know, at this stage of the game, then that would be something that you would also want to do, just using internal applied intent, you know, using visualization, you know, to also go in and identify the different areas that you feel may be weak in the body or in the chakra system and apply the intent to heal those tears.
Okay.
Right. And I would suggest also, of course, is to cleanse your aura, and one of the best ways to do it is with sea salt. You know, you would soak yourself in the water for about 20 minutes or so.
I just did that. That's
right.
That's
well,
amazing.
That means your spirit already telling you what to do.
Yeah, I just did that.
That removed the negative bioplasmic energy in which that is surrounding your auric field, which is negative debris. And oftentimes it is caused because of the negative programming that we have within our minds, and which is detrimental, or because of negative thought forms in which that has been hurled at us because of other people, as Brother Wayne was talking about with elementals. And also what can be done within pranic healing, we was taught that if you do one of the three breath techniques, which is empty retention or 7171 or 6363, you actually can.
Which I've been practicing.
Right, which of course you can expand your auric field from 3 feet, which is basically the average person's auric field outside of their physical body, to actually 15 feet or more, you know, once you reach the 100 breath. So continue doing those exercises, and you would definitely be where you need to be at.
Yeah, and I would add to that, when you do those breathing exercises, what's your process when you do the 6-3 or the 7-1? What's your process?
I have been practicing, and I don't know if I'm doing this in the correct order, working on getting my breath to, I think it was 24 or 36 breaths a minute. Is that correct?
You're talking about...
That's something different. Like, okay, so what Dr. Arlene Bay was saying, you know, I mean, in terms of he's talking about creating a much stronger impenetrable density for the sheet that surrounds your body, you know, to keep you safe, you know, from
the auric field.
Right, exactly.
Right.
So that technique, you know, is dependent on two factors. One is you want to use Kachari Mudra because the tongue is connected when you do that. And the second is that you're breathing from the lower belly. You're breathing from around the lower abdomen, you know, because that's the area that generates, you know, a much denser, much more extensive field of protection around you.
Okay.
So if you're doing those, then, yeah, those are two... you know, exemplary forms of protection, you know, that you can use to just increase and solidify your shield of protection.
And you said that Tukar Mudra?
Tongue connection. To take the tip of your tongue and put it along the roof of, there's a ridge that runs along the top of the roof of your mouth. Now, there are three points that run along that ridge. But even if you just take the tip and put it on the ridge, you know, you have connectivity.
Okay.
Right, what that
and
does
that
is...
And that connectivity to the top of the head?
Well, the energy runs freely through the body at that point. When it's disconnected, the energy still runs, but it don't run with the power and with the intensity of when the tongue is there. And also, you will want to do, if you can, the root. Lock, which is actually pulling up your vaginal and anal muscles as you take your tongue and put there in order to create what is called a microcosmic rotation or orbit, in which that helps with intensifying the expansion of your auric field, too.
Okay. I really appreciate this.
But get Mantak Chia's books. One in particular is Cultivating Female Energy.
Cultivating Female Energy. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you all so very much. Have a blessed night.
You too.
All right, we have another caller. Area code 111, you're on the line. Meaning that it's private. So
okay,
come on in.
I was going to say, I've never heard of area code 111.
But you have the hand up, schools. Come on in if you know that you're the one that have called in private.
Peace.
You call 111.
Peace. Can you hear me?
We can, brother.
Peace. This is Brother Messiah. My bad for coming up private. Now, the only reason I was calling is because I heard the brother Azar get on the phone. If that was him, and he said he needed you to call him, and whether he had your number or not, I got his number. I could shoot it to you if that was him.
Okay, I have his number here still on the screen, but but if not, definitely call me back and give me that after the show here.
Okay, no doubt.
All right, thank you.
All right, peace.
Peace. All right, area code 314, area code 314. I believe this is my man, Rhettland L. How you doing, brother?
Peace and honor, Brother Dr. Arlene.
All right.
Yes, I was listening to you earlier when you were talking about the chemtrails. I didn't realize, I guess I was ignorant of the fact that when I walked down the street, I thought they were actually spider webs.
Because
I walked down the street, I see a spider web, look like a spider web from this light post all the way across the street. And I almost said to myself, I said, boy, you know, I didn't know spiders can do that. But what you just said really enlightened me that that was a chemtrail that fell down to Earth and how they're setting up spider webs around us. Now I'm more enlightened on that. And also about Brother Wayne Chandler when he said they had to integrate within ourselves and in order to, like, the two days the experience in 2 days, you won't be yourself. No, you won't, how did he say, you won't be the same. And is that dealing with when you come back, when you get through with the five-day course, when you come back to the city, when you look at society in a different light, what exactly what do you mean by that?
I mean that you have certain faculties, you know, that exist within your body that you don't utilize. You're not even aware of them.
Mm-hmm.
Most of us are not even aware of the organs and the glands in our body because they exist in an unseen domain. And because they're unseen, you know, we don't really have a connection or a relationship with them. So when you establish relationship, you know, with that unseen, you know, environment, terrain in your body, and we begin to, like, open up specific or activate specific energetic patterns, then you shift. You begin to change. Now, there's a whole, you know, I mean, I could get into, you know, the depth of the science with respect to, you know, cellular DNA and, you know, that whole element which they're finding now that, you know, basically, in essence, when you introduce, you know, new programs to the body, you know, it makes the body manufacture new strands of DNA, which basically shifts you into a much different place. So you become something other than what you were prior to the introduction of these new vibrational frequencies. Every frequency that hits your body makes the cell respond to a certain formula that it then tells the various proteins in your body to manufacture, you know, a new protein configuration, which that in turn makes a various DNA strand which determines your behavior. So what happens when you begin to introduce new, unfounded, unknown energetic signatures into your body? So when they begin to hit and basically overrun the cells with these new vibrational frequencies, the brain of the cell is on the outside. It's in what's called the ectoderm. It's the outside of the cell.
Mm.
So when these vibrational frequencies hit the cells, the cell, the brain of the cell, then orders a configuration within the DNA to begin to create a new type of behavioral pattern that begins to permeate through your being. So, for example, instead of having the energetic signature of grief, of anger, of fear, which is what your body is more used to experiencing, to have a different type of energetic signature that's coming from a much higher dimensional field that deals with transcendental consciousness, that deals with the exploration of new, unfounded genetic signatures initiated or stimulated by the production of Qigong practices or Nigong techniques. You know, these techniques, when they create these new patterns of DNA, shift you into being something other than you were prior to your arrival in that place. Not only do they shift you into something other than what you were prior to your arrival, but they take the old signatures that you came in with and allow you to create a certain internal mechanism or construct to begin the neutralization of those old patterns and old ways.
That would be a revolution of the self, wouldn't it?
Oh, no question.
And then, so therefore, I have, my character would be a more of a positive
exactly
nature. Okay, I get you on that. And so most people that was close to me, like family relatives or friends, they wouldn't hardly know me like they used to.
They're going to know you however you want them to know you, because a lot of times, you know, you're going to resonate a different frequency, and people are going to, like, immediately know that something has changed in you, that you're different. They're not going to know specifically what that difference is unless you lay it out there and let them know that, yeah, well, this is how I roll now. But, you know, if you don't want to get into that type of, you know, specificity, then you don't have to go there. That's your choice. That's your decision. But, yeah, people are going to be able to feel definitely a different type of resonance from your being when they get around you. You know, the whole thing, and this is one of the great, powerful designs with respect to shifting consciousness. And this, you have Dr. David Hawkins, you know. So David R. Hawkins, back in the day, you know, he wrote a book called Power Versus Force. And he was able to, like, calibrate different emotional fields. Make a long story short, he was able to take, like, the emotional field, like, say, of fear, which is 200, and compare that to the emotional field of unconditional love, which is, like, vibrating at 500. He was able to see that a person who is enveloped in the field of unconditional love is vibrating at such a high frequency that without touching, engaging, coming in contact with in any way, shape, form, or fashion can elevate 750,000 people just by being in that state. You as an individual being in that state. Because the greatest illusion living in a compartmentalized reality and culture like the one we live in is that nothing is connected, where the reality in truth is that everything is connected.
Okay.
Everything.
Okay.
So when you ascend, when you do the kind of work that literally creates an increase, substantial increase in your vibrational field, that increase is sent out to many other individuals that you are connected to. The ancient Kemites or the Egyptians believe that every individual that incarnates on this earth is connected to at least 2,000 souls. So if you are taking the lead in terms of your own ability to ascend and transcend, when you begin to vibrate at a higher level, a higher rate, you automatically create a wave that begins to elevate and allow those other 2,000 souls that are connected to you to ascend and vibrate at a higher ratio as well.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, and also, Brother L., according to the teachings of Gervalo Melchizedek on the Tree of Life, or the Flower of Life in particular, he also stated that with a soulmate, and Brother Wayne broke this down earlier tonight, even more powerful, a twin flame or soul, you actually could come together and actually expand the auric field once you do the Macabre technique and actually bring in 144,000. So, I mean, that is how powerful the auric field and the resonation of love, you know, can become, you know. So, you know, we definitely want to thank you for coming on and checking us out. Is there any other questions that you wanted to go into, or that's it? And because we're about over.
Yes, sir.
And I definitely want to thank Brother Wayne. Definitely want to thank him for coming on. I appreciate him. Brother Wayne, we would love to have you on again anytime. We appreciate you, brother.
I appreciate the invite, my brother. It's been great. It's been awesome.
Yes, sir.
All right. Well, we're getting ready to head out, y'all.
First World Order Radio, finally. We are on the air, no doubt. All right.
The there's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. Order. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories, shit that works.